price.
There is one amendment that needs to be made on the tender apologies. Philip Tiffany is actually Tiffany Philip, and two words.
Thank you. That has been noted. Councillor Brown.
Just a question, really, on the funding. Number three, Eden Church School. Is that a joint school, or it's not one school, there are two schools? Is it a combined school activity, or what is it?
Yes.
Through you, Madam Mayor. Yes, it is. So Eden Church School have made a joint application to cover up the funding.
Councillor Price.
Also another point of clarification, the terms of reference of the Creative Communities group states that there should be a representative from Metro Art Gallery on it, and currently there is none.
Okay, so I've just been advised by our committee secretary that not all members of the council have that information in front of them, but it can come back through a FABS, future FABS meeting, and we can clarify that membership. Thank you for pointing that out. Are there any further questions? And Councillor Price, you moved that we receive the minutes, is that correct? I wrote it down early, I apologise. So Councillor Price has moved. Councillor Bell? Thank you. So all in favour that we receive the minutes of the Creative Communities Fund Assessment Committee meeting held on the 22nd of May, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Carried. Okay, we're a little early. We have visitors coming at 2 o'clock to speak to us regarding the MAR group representation. And then we have a couple of other speakers. So I'll just jump to the Mayor's report, please. Item 6.9. Which is on page number 42. And I wish to move receipt of the report, please. Seconder. Councillor Bell? Thank you. So, councillors, the report is open for discussion. I did have a note here that Councillor Brown would be giving a verbal report on his visit to rural and provincial, but we will postpone that for a future meeting. Are there any questions on the report? Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. On page 43, your report on the top, regional funding for Christchurch multi-use arena.
Yes.
Can you explain or expand on that?
Yes, as I have advised in the past, there has been some preliminary discussion that Christchurch City Council are interested in a regional charge for the multi-use arena in Christchurch. They have also flagged at the next meeting it will come up for discussion again. I have no papers to present to you at this stage, and as soon as I do have any papers, I will share. But there is, as I have indicated, a desire that become a regional charge.
And that would be charged to a regional council, not to Christchurch City, if adopted.
Potentially, but again, haven't seen the papers. We're still in early discussions, but I have conveyed the message I have received from this council in the past that, based on the information we had, because very little, there was not a desire to do so. Councillor Wilson.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. On page 45, are we going to discuss the agreements from local government conference before we close this discussion?
Absolutely, yes. In fact, would you like to do that now, Councillor Wilson? Okay, Committee Secretary is suggesting that we start on page 42. There is a recommendation there, and this, I apologise, is after the event. Prior to Deputy Mayor Neil Brown and Bruce Moffat heading to China, I did discuss with Chief Executive Dalzell if we could take some funding from economic development. He was in support. However, that has put our acting CEO in a difficult position because she did not have approval from council. And so just to dot the I's and cross the T's, I'm moving the recommendation as written there that council approves payment of 7751.11 being the travel cost for Deputy Mayor Neil Brown and Bruce Moffat from the Economic Development Fund. Do I have a second? Councillor Lovett,
I'll take a second that.
Thank you. The matter is now open for debate. Councillor Lawson.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. I'm opposed. I'm quite happy for Councillor Deputy Mayor to go, but Bruce Moffat from Prince Canterbury, if we give them $200,000, I think they could fund themselves.
As I said, this one is retrospective, and I did have a discussion with the CE prior to his departure. Councillor Brown?
Having travelled to China with Mr. Moffat, he did add great value to our China trip because I and Mr. Priest had never been there before. So having someone who knows the ropes, so to speak, was beneficial.
Councillor Price.
I also noticed that the cost of Mr. Moffat was less than the cost of Councillor Brown.
Ways. One might be one set up front of the plane and one set down the back, but that is not the reason. The reason is that Mr. Moffat had to go to Melbourne, I think it was Australia, for a something he was attending. So the trip to Melbourne was cheaper than the trip to Christchurch.
Councillor Ellis.
Thank you. I'm in support of the recommendation, but I would like to see us put some guidelines around our economic development fund. It feels to me like it's becoming a slush fund and we tend to be dipping into it because it's there for different things, and I'd like to see us put some guidelines around what we can use that money for. Otherwise suddenly we'll have something that I feel truly that falls into economic development and the money won't be there for it.
And that measure is coming up later in our agenda on page 105 of the Chief Thank you. So, I will put recommendation. All in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Carried. So, Councillor Wilson, you are quite right. The remits are there for local government in New Zealand, and in fact, we have also provided you with full details of them. Starting on page 59, the first remit number one is that local government works with central government to develop a nationally consistent regime of wastewater testing to enable a solid basis for testing drug use in our communities.
Agree.
I don't think we need to vote on them, but can I just perhaps see a show of hands, who is in support? I declare that carried. Number two, rural roads policy. Okay, so could I see a show of hands in support of the HCV rural roads policy, please? Oh, I'll declare that carry. So heritage buildings. Any discussion on heritage buildings, please? Are you in support, councillors? Okay, so you are asking me to vote against that. Is that what I've just seen?
I think it's difficult us instructing you here, fully, without you having heard the debate that will happen and the reasoning for some of these at the conference. Otherwise, we're going in showing predetermination if you're going there knowing how you can vote before we go.
The difficulty is I'm representing this council, so I need some, I guess I need, I can happily go and vote and stand on favour if that's what you would rather I did. Councillor Brown.
I think on that one, I'm neutral on it,
yes.
So you vote as you see, but yes. After you've heard the
the discussion or the presentation on that one.
Okay.
I'm neutral.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm against it. We have to have our own policies, and we down here know which buildings which we think we're worth saving. So if we're going to be guided from somewhere else, just not.
So what I am reading is that local government lobbies for greater support for and protection of heritage buildings.
And increased funds.
Guiding us from afar.
Trust
me. We've got enough to do it here.
Okay. If, taking on board your point, Councillor Ellis, I am at the AGM, and there is a persuasive argument against the directive that has been given here at council. I will come back and convey to you what that persuasive argument was. Climate change, advocate to banks. You want to talk house to you, Councillor Ellis?
I don't care about putting any problem at all, it's like the government poking their nose into the major banks' business and leaving their business to do what they want to do, and just leave them to it. Sometimes not secure.
I see the rationale is slightly different. I see that central government has been a party to the Paris Agreement and have come back and are trying to work with local government, and local government are trying to influence in a way to progress the agreement that this country has signed. But I may need my own voice. Councillor Rippey.
Right, asked Councillor Brown, did he see real evidence on his China trip that China is actually actively going out to have low carbon everywhere?
They're certainly doing their best. They have a lot of electric vehicles.
Yes.
There's a lot of trees. They were a lot more environmentally friendly than I thought they were.
Yeah.
They do have haze sitting 2 kilometres out, which has come from somewhere, but they do have a lot of coal burning in the area. Coal fire for generation of electricity. And no big black smoke coming out of them, just a little bit of white smoke coming out. You wouldn't know they were there, but they do have pollution, not sure where it comes from. They are well ahead of us, I believe.
This is an opportunity for us to address that, Councillor Wilson.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm opposed to this remit. I think, who are we to tell the local banks what they can and can't do? I mean, they can say all those local bodies that voted for this will pay another 5% on their interest. I mean, if we're going to try and tell them what we want them to do, they can tell us what they want to do to us. So I think this is just ridiculous.
If we read the actual remit, we're talking about application, we're not talking about advocacy, rather. Application, yeah. We're not talking about telling the banks what to do. We can't tell the banks what to do, but we can advocate and pay for them.
We could make a stand, this council could, or the government could, and not deal with any banks that have non-zero emission. I don't know where we would get our money from, but we could make a stand.
But Councillor Brown, can I remind you that Councillor Price tried to introduce an ethical policy and it was not supported? So, the remit as it sits is that local government, consistent with local government position statement on climate change 2017 and the local government leaders climate change declaration 2017, which I did not get support to sign, advocate to all major banks that they transition away from investments in fossil fuel industries and consider opportunities for long-term investments in low or zero carbon energy systems. So, could I see a show of hands, who is in support of that remit? 1, 2, 3, 4. So, I will take that as a no. Okay, number 5, Climate Change Adaptation Fund. Councillor Brown.
Thank you.
that we ask local government to call on central government to establish a climate change adaptation fund to improve local level and community participation in responding to climate change. Curiously, on the news this week, I saw that the number of insurance claims that have gone through on climate change consequences with cyclones and flooding is at an all-time high this year. So I actually think to have central government establish a climate change adaptation fund to improve community participation and local level responses is an extremely positive thing. So I'm keen to support. Is anyone opposed to that sentiment?
Well, not opposed, but we probably should have district plans throughout the country. We don't have people build in flood-prone areas and have foundations like there were in the house back 80 or 100 years ago, which were 600 above the ground level, the present ground level, which kept nearly everything around this country out of. We have a number of places around where we were built on the flood. So we probably need some lifting and getting back to putting decent foundations back.
That unfortunately is not covered in this remit, but can I just add that I did write down that news article. I'm better than I thought I was. 2018 to the end of May, $204 million has been paid out in insurance on flooding and cyclones. The total insurance equivalent for the year before, the whole year, was $243 million. So by May, we're already at $204. Councillor Wilson.
Yes, I'm opposed to this as well. I agree exactly with what Councillor Webley said. We've seen it in this town. People have had built subdivisions on areas that previously were declared non-suitable for subdivisions. And one such subdivision nearly flooded in July last year. And that was why it wasn't used. It was because it wasn't an area. And I think, not that I'm totally against the application of climate change, I think it's overrated in a huge way. Every flood and we haven't had a big flood in Ashburton for about 50 years, and suddenly it'll be climate change. It's not. It's a cycle of variation of climates. And adaption fund, don't think that we won't be getting away from not paying into it. These sort of things have got to happen with all taxpayers subsidising somebody to develop an area that should never have been developed.
Councillor Wilson and Rivoli, maybe in the next 11 months we're preparing for the next local government New Zealand annual general meeting. The two of you might like to do some work and prepare a remit on what you'd like to see. Perhaps. Councillor Robinson.
I totally agree with the two previous speakers, and I was about to say what Peter actually said. And even in my time in insurance, many times you see people build houses, stupid places, and I think that to have an adaptation fund is not what's needed. I think it's local government and rules need to be changed around where people situate properties. And I think we'll see that coming through the insurance industry. So I'm not in support of having a fund to start adapting to change. I think that it needs to be done in a more proactive way by limiting where people can live.
And that working group, Councillor Price.
Thank you. I actually agree with the three previous speakers, but this climate change is bigger than just localised flooding. This is something that has affected communities right across the country. And we've seen it in Northland, we've seen it in Taranaki, we've seen it elsewhere. To have centralised funding to help out local governments to adapt to the effects of climate change, how is that a bad thing? I suspect the problem is the phrase climate change that people are opposing.
Councillor Irvin?
Yeah, I support the previous speakers there. It's something I think our local bodies need to take in hand rather than being told perhaps from central government. The funds do have to come from somewhere, and yours truly here will be paying into it. And I think our local rules have to change to make sure that buildings and things aren't built in these stupid places. And as Councillor Wilson said, we haven't really had a decent flood in 50 years, and it will happen. And there's going to be a lot of insurance claims because the stuff is very marginal
work on a agreement for the local government for next year instead of a climate change adaption fund. They could just use a common sense fund to teach people some damn good common sense.
I heard a saying that common sense isn't that common anymore.
Correct, and there's a fund to bring it back.
Councillor Lovett.
I did agree with them. We've got to get back to the sensible rules and regulations that can't be overturned in court by environmental or whatever. That's my thoughts.
Councillor Gough.
I just want to ask everyone here, what about last year's flooding? Is that not flooding in Australia?
Please use the microphone.
That would be commonplace, but I think 1 in 10 years is about what we call this one. You should expect 1 in 10 years of our infrastructure held. We didn't have deep tank anything extra infrastructure again. The stop bank for 1 in 200 year flood, it would have stopped the flood in 1945, but we've gone over the top. 1945 flood after the next mile ahead was more big than that. So I think we built a stop bank around town for about 1800 cubic meters, but estimated to 2-3. So what we've had is just a probably what we used to get like once every 5 years, but now getting it once every 10 years. So what we had, the weather was pretty small.
Councillors, we're getting a wee bit away from the remit that's here in front of us.
I have your information, carry on.
Thank you. Chief Executive Bolt.
Just thought I should perhaps point out maybe here that councils don't have the power that a lot of people think we have in terms of where you can and cannot build. And I remember years ago a former boss of mine, Christchurch City Council, fighting tooth and nail to stop building on South Shore Spit. That went all the way to court and the council lost. So you say that common sense, well, it's a lot harder to do than what you think. I also think that with climate change, you're going to see an increasing severity and frequency of events, and places that were previously okay to build on will become less tenable at the time that they were approved. It probably wasn't a big issue, so going forward it will become a bigger problem.
And councillors, can I just point out to you that this remit has been proposed by Christchurch City Council and it is supported by our neighbour Selwyn District Council. So their climate, their location is very similar to ours. They face similar issues to us. Councillor Price.
Can I just back that up by saying that if councillors have read to the end of that particular remit, they will see examples from Christchurch that are not talking about localised funding. You know, I'll reiterate what I said before. I suspect that people saw the title and decided it was a great vote, but perhaps reading the whole remit would be useful.
Councillor Reveley, before you go, anything else you'd like to state anything against climate change, I should just note and welcome our guests here, including Commissioner Cagle.
Just a little correction. You said Selwyn and Christchurch, both those two decisions, probably.
Okay, councillors, so I am in support of the remit for the adaptation fund. Can I see a show of hands? Who else is in support of the adaptation fund? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have received your message loud. I'm just seeking some direction, just clarifying for our guests on local government APM remits, and I've got about 6 more to do, and a couple of things more to do. So next, councillors, we're looking at page 78, sale and supply of alcohol. Am I to support this remit? Okay, so show of hands, please. Support. Page number 81, item 7,
biofuels. Councillor
Wilson.
Madam Mayor, this is the most stupid, ridiculous remit I've ever heard of. The United States did this when the
fossil fuel went up a few years ago, and a lot of the Midwest went into growing corn for biofuel, and it totally skewed the feed market for grain feeding, and people only grew maize to make it to biofuels, which was only profitable because it was a huge government subsidy. Our present government was short-sighted enough to cancel future prospecting for oil and gas, and here this sort of agreement said let's pour the subsidy into biodiesel, growing oilseed rape and maize and stuff to make diesel. Well, ask yourself how stupid can you get? I think this is an utterly ridiculous. If they thought about what happened in the United States to this sort of thing, they would realise it's totally impractical. And once more, we've got Christchurch City and Selwyn, so I think they would better look at themselves.
I would have to agree with this because we've been there and done that, growing all the seed rape down through the Mackenzie, and we cannot grow up between the two rivers here, otherwise we will not have an arable seed industry because of the oil seed rape. It contaminates all our small seeds. And when they did do trials on it here, it did not work and they couldn't pay. So to me, it's a no-brainer.
So when you say agree with this, you mean Councillor Wilson?
I agree with Councillor Wilson.
Okay. Thank you.
We cannot push this, otherwise we won't have an arable industry.
Councillor Brown.
I agree with two previous speakers, and note on the first bullet point there, it says with the decrease of global oil prices. I'm not sure when this was written, but I haven't seen the global oil prices dropping at all. They've gone the other way, but the price has been for obviously great years. So, I think it's without a filter of certain rules.
Councillor Price.
Thank you. Once again, I urge people to read the actual remit. Whereas the remit asks, encourages the government to investigate. Now, whether we agree with it or not, carbon emissions have year on year increased dramatically, and what the three previous speakers are essentially doing is encouraging that trend to carry on for the foreseeable future until we run out of fossil fuels. What is wrong with investigating the possibility of alternative fuels that do not, that in the 21st century, that do not have the same level of carbon emissions as the current fuels we're using?
Councillor Readily.
Okay. The subsidies really disturbed me. If anything's useful, it should be able to stand on its own. This work's been done in lots of places. Sydney run their bus pilot on a 5-year trial. They've now taken the off because of the amount of fuel that they're using. They're actually using more diesel to get through with the biofuel, and that they're using as high levels as they could. So they give it a fair crack, and that's gone now. So this has been done before. We just need to read a little bit of paper that we're out there saying it's on. So somebody can do it, and they can do it without a subsidy. We will accept it. We shouldn't subsidise it because it just puts false thing. Farmers look without subsidies associated with the fuel industry.
Okay, I'm going to flip this question the other way this time. If I see a show of hands, those against the remit, please. Okay, thank you. Item number 8, page 83, walking report, single-use plastics.
Yeah, no, I think we probably would have to run this one to the best way to do the sky, so let's get it cracked up.
Councillor Brown?
Agreeing with most of it. The single-use plastics, we're talking about plastic bags at the supermarket. That is the tip of the iceberg. Open up that plastic bag and get to the supermarket and see what product is stored in plastic. And here is truckloads of them there. This is the tip of the iceberg. Somewhere to start, it's got to go a lot further. And is that the one way you're going to get rid of plastics in this environment, stop the whales and the turtles and whatever you're eating it, is to burn the stuff and get rid of it. Burn it properly. Burn it properly.
Or stop producing it
from whales. Great point. Stop producing it. But we've seen the footage on TV where there's oceans of this plastic.
So in one way you're going to get rid of it, and that is good.
I'm just taking on board your point about this being the tip of the iceberg. I heard a quote recently that even a waterfall starts with a single drip. Any further speakers for or against? So could I see a show of hands, those against, please? Great, so I'm just going to support on that one, thank you. Page number 86, item 9, mandatory register of cooling towers. Okay, the advice I'm receiving from Chief Executive Donaldson is it's a very good idea. So could I see, show of hands, those against? Trying to save your hand raising, that is a yes. Page 19, number 10, copper and brake pads. Environment Canterbury have put this remit. That local government calls for central government to introduce legislation to limit or eliminate the copper content of vehicle brake pads to reduce contaminants in our urban waterways.
Totally opposed. Who are we to tell vehicle manufacturers? I mean, the amount of vehicles that we use in New Zealand are a tiny, tiny little bit. Is the world going to produce special brake pads for New Zealand? Goodness sake. If it's done as a worldwide thing, we will obviously piggyback on what happens overseas. Our vehicle density, even in Auckland, is nothing like it is in the major cities overseas. And if they find that they have, this is a major problem, they will lobby or bring legislation for vehicle manufacturers that they have to abide by a certain standard. For us to try and have a standard that's different to the rest of the world, I think is ridiculous.
Councillor Wilson, in response to your who are we are the 13 elected leaders for a district of 34,000 people. We are 1/10 of Environment Canterbury, and Environment Canterbury are asking local government New Zealand, who represents 100% of all territorial and regional authorities, to lobby central government to make a change.
When I say who are we, I mean New Zealand motoring public. Who are, as a country, who are we to tell motoring manufacturers overseas what to do? We haven't got any push. As far as Environment Canterbury, just because Environment Canterbury proposed it doesn't mean to say we have to support them. We're our own person, I think.
Don't disagree with that sentiment. Councillor Price.
Thank you. Once again, I'd like to reiterate that if the remit is actually read in full, you might find things like the United States EPA committed in 2015. So we're 3 years behind where the US is. If we are serious about cleaning up waterways in this country, we are serious about cleaning up both urban and rural waterways, and I don't see why we shouldn't support something that works towards that end.
Councillor Brown.
I would change the remit if I could. In fact, next year might be the one. We agree that LGNZ calls for the central government to introduce legislation to limit or reduce contaminants in our urban waterways, which will remove the copper, it will remove the rubber, the fuel, the rock shit, everything from our urban waterways. It's not just brake pads, it's do the whole thing. Urban waterways, time to work on it. We've missed them out over the years. Auckland's getting hammered at the moment for these beaches. Christchurch needs to do something with their urban waterways. Time to start.
Councillor Rollins.
I'd just like to say I support this one. I think it's like the plastic bags, it's got to have small beginnings, and totally support it.
Okay, councillors, those in support, can I see a show of hands, please? Thank you. I can accept. I thought, proposal from Wellington City Council and Christchurch City Council. So, first, Councillor Reveley.
Right, at the bottom of that one, so there is the clear cause eco waste and chemicals as priority, probably come with this waste minimisation. When you buy chemicals today, you have to be a registered person to do it, and they have to account for every last drop of that chemical. I'm not sure where they're headed here, and unless it's a town people got a handful, but every chemical we buy now, we have to be able to clear where it comes from, where it goes. So, this is obviously for somebody who doesn't hold a certificate, so they can actually buy it, but not everyone can buy chemicals now. And you have to not only go to buy it, you have to have another certificate to use it, so.
Okay, we're going to put down in the detail though, thank you, Councillor Reveley. So just on the remit, are we in support of the remit? Okay, so, Councillor Lovett.
I'll just look ahead to the chemical we do discuss this, because I agree with Councillor Reveley on the step from the chemical one. Where are they going to head with it? Because if you can't keep disadvantaging the farming community, you are putting up higher costs on the reduced waste. You're really going to be careful, because people just start going offshore and manufacturing, they're doing stuff overseas if we're just going to make it too tough in the environment here to operate businesses.